Hello, everybody. It is Mike Young with the plantbaseddiet.org, and we're back again for another informative and exciting talk with Sid Notter. Welcome, Sid.
Thanks, Mike. It's great to be back with you again.
Yes. Yeah, same here. I know today we have a really interesting topic, and it's one that applies to everyone, I think, at least. Or if it doesn't apply to you right now, you're trying to avoid it. It's the five big disconnects between nutrition and health. So I'm really interested to hear about all this stuff. And I know that a lot of this stuff is from your book too, right? You have written a book called The Plan A Diet.
It's right here, The Plan A Diet. You can find it on Amazon or my website, sidnotter.com.
Awesome.
And this information is actually from the book.
Good, good. Okay.
And so the reason it's called The Big Disconnects is when you think about all the things we do for prevention, and I talk about this in the book, that we wear seatbelts to prevent injury and we install burglar alarms to prevent theft and we have our cars tuned up to prevent breakdowns. And I go through this big list.
Right.
And we even put oil on our pets to prevent fleas, right? But we don't think about how food is going to prevent disease in our bodies. We don't give much thought to that. So yes. This is where I came up with the five big disconnects between nutrition and health.
Okay. All right. Well, let's jump right into it. What's the first one?
The first one is not understanding the cause and effect of food. So, you know, the immediate pain results when we touch a hot stove or we step on a sliver, right?
We
know where the pain's coming from.
Yes.
When it comes to a poor diet, there's time that elapses between eating food and getting sick. For the most part, there's time in between there.
Yes.
And
so
people are unlikely to connect those dots and therefore they're unlikely to change. Now, there are some conditions, like if you have acid reflux or allergies or migraines, some of those are easily traced to something that we just ate. But for the most part, people are not connecting those two dots.
Yeah, I was having some discussions recently on this exact topic. So this is very interesting to me because I agree with like 99% of what you just said there, because I think almost everyone cannot draw that. There's such a long time frame between eating and the disease happening that they don't draw that direct correlation. And if they think there's a correlation, it's, well, maybe, you know, we're not sure. But I will tell you with me, I feel this stuff immediately. That's what makes me different from most people, because like when I have a junk food meal, I can feel it. I'm just telling you, I feel it right away. I've always been this way. And I'd say it's gotten more and more so to be this way as I've become older and I've become better with my nutrition and diet, because, you know, the closer you are to optimal, the more you're going to feel that immediate hit of something less than optimal. And I guess that's my curse. I don't know, my curse or my blessing, depending on how you look at it, because I can't get away from that. I would love to get away from that and be like your average Joe or Jane, but I can't. So
that's a blessing. And I agree, the more optimally we eat, the more we're going to feel it when we eat some crappy food, right?
Yes.
So wouldn't it be nice if the public, they ate a cheeseburger and immediately felt some chest pain, or they ate some glazed donuts and then they felt like they were getting arthritis? You know, wouldn't it be nice if that happened right away, but it usually doesn't.
Yeah, our work and your work would be so much easier, right? Wouldn't that convince anyone?
I say that right in the book. My job would be a lot easier if this was the case.
Yeah.
So big disconnect number two is I'm on meds, so I no longer have a problem. I see this all the time. Some of my clients consider themselves to be in really good health, but they're on a lot of daily medications. And they're not thinking that they have a problem anymore because the medications have changed their biomarkers, or they're simply feeling better. But the root cause of their illness is still there.
Yeah. So do these folks in general, from your observations, do they believe that the root cause has been addressed with these medications?
They do. They have a false sense of security about it because they're feeling better and their doctors aren't telling them any different, you know, just stay on this medication forever. But yet, as we know from Dr. Esselstyn's research, too, that people that just moderately lower their fat intake, they feel better, but the disease continues to progress.
Right.
I'm afraid that's what's happening with a lot of people. They still have the issue, but the meds are making them feel like they're they're fixed. The problem has been addressed. And yeah. So
let me ask you a question about that. A little tangent off of that. I think that a lot of this may arise from the thinking that I think the average person has also, that medical doctors are some type of miracle workers. You know, like, oh, they have access to this this pharmaceutical, whatever, here. This is the miracle. This is the, or as close to miracle as you could get. But I think the reality is, I think that you know that you have more ability to positively control your health through your own actions, right?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, right. I'm thinking of a Homer Simpson episode one time when he went to the doctor and the doctor said, you really need to eat better and exercise. And he said, can't you just give me pills and surgery? I mean, that's
yeah. Yeah, it's sad. I mean, I'm laughing, but it's sad because it's just not, word on the street is not what we're talking about, right? Word on the street is not, oh, you can just eat some of the stuff behind me and you'll bring your whole life in the balance. You know, that's not word on the street. Word on the street is, oh, I'm not feeling quite well. I need to go jump into the sick care system, which is what we really have right now, and then they'll address it for me.
Right. So the drugs often are making their biomarkers fall within range, you know, but they're not addressing the root cause of why they're sick in the first place.
Good point. Yep.
That's a big disconnect.
All right.
So the third one, are you ready?
Yeah. Oh, I'm ready. I'm definitely.
The third one is, it runs in my family, so it's out of my control. Right? How many times have we heard that misconception that diet and lifestyle don't matter because disease X runs in my family?
Genetics.
And basically, I'm a helpless victim to my genes.
Yeah. What I say to folks, I try to gently encourage them when I hear this, is that yes, everyone has a certain leaning towards or a certain tendency towards, or some people are more sensitive. Like I tell you, I'm more sensitive to everything I eat, right? But that just means you have to adjust based on that, right? Because there's no two people are the same and we don't want to all be the same.
Right. And even if you are predisposed to some genetic thing, does not mean that those genes will express. There's a big difference between genetic predisposition and genetic expression.
Yeah.
Diet is the trigger in most cases. So if you think that you're pre-programmed for some disease, the good news is that no, you're not. I mean, I've read that genetics are responsible for only about 3% of our health outcomes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I think that also another part of this that I have witnessed is that when folks will use the family history or the genetics angle, I'll say, well, it's also that those are also people that taught you all your habits, whether you realize it or not, you know, so you've got those same habits, the same lifestyle as those folks before you.
Yes. And in the book, I talk about Dr. T. Colin Campbell. He had an article that said, suppose you are, that you've got the gene responsible for liver cancer. This is something Dr. Campbell talked about.
Yeah.
That gene can be dramatically repressed by consuming less animal protein and thereby delaying or preventing liver cancer. And he points out that the enzymes, the production of enzymes, which are the main products of gene expression, can be markedly controlled by what we eat.
Yeah, so very good, very good.
Predisposed for Alzheimer's too, for example, we know that there's a gene, the APOE4 gene for Alzheimer's. We know that is totally triggered by saturated fat, cholesterol, and other factors.
Yeah. So when people say that they've got this known family history, right? That should, in my mind, that should highlight an area that they need to be extra careful about, right?
Exactly.
And I wish that the general consensus would view it like that, because like you and Dr. Campbell are saying that you can actually have positive results if you recognize that I got to take extra care here, and you do take the extra care, then you will have positive results in most cases.
Correct. You know what we say, genetics may load the gun, but lifestyle pulls the trigger, right? We always say that.
Yeah.
Genes can only establish the potential for disease. They are not a guarantee that you're going to get disease. Diet is by far the biggest determinant.
Yes. And
Dr. McDougall, he points out too, that good genes are turned on by a healthy gut environment, whereas bad genes are silenced, and bad genes are silenced by a healthy environment. So the more good gut bacteria we have, And we know what feeds good gut bacteria, right? Is fiber, starch. All the stuff behind you there. So I think sometimes too, people give their genetic excuse as a way of not even trying to make changes. You know,
yes.
It's a handy excuse.
Exactly. That's what I see. I see, well, this is out of my control, right? Like, I can't control this. Don't you understand? I just can't control this. Some things are out of your control. I guess it's not out of control with you, so you don't understand. Mm-hmm. You know,
pointed out, it's mostly the diet pattern that's been passed down through their family, not as well as the genes. They've also learned a diet that's probably not the best.
Oh, yeah. Yes. All right. Yeah. So that's number three of the five, right?
Yeah. Big disconnect number four is making small changes, but expecting big results. Mm. And I see this all the time. So some people are comfortable just making small dietary changes and others jump in with both feet, as you probably have experienced, you know, in your circles as well. And some fall in between, you know, they're willing to go full board, but they're going to take gradual steps to get there. So
that's what I see more often than not, is that first part you described, which is they just do a little, right? I even see it on communities online. People are complaining, hey, I'm eating whole food plant-based, but my blood pressure is still out of control. Yeah. And I kind of know what's going on. I'm like, I'm sure they're eating processed food. They're eating way too much sodium. I know that, you know, you and I know 1500 milligrams for the entire day. Sometimes you can get that in more than one meal. And that's at a high level. People should be way, way below that. You know, just eat food as grown with no added sodium at all. And occasionally I will see, I won't go in there myself, but I'll watch and I'll see, well, someone will come and say, look, I know your blood pressure is still high, but come on. I know you're not sticking to this. You're just going and you're just checking it out a little bit. But if you really did, you'd actually see the results.
Right. It's the overall dietary pattern that matters, right? Sometimes I'll see that people will, they'll put daily flaxseed in a dairy-based smoothie. Or they'll put some broccoli in a steak stir fry, you know,
that's it.
They'll put some blueberries on their cheesecake. And they think that just because
the cheesecake,
you know, that they're going to see results. And then when they don't, they say, well, I tried that and it didn't work. No, they didn't try it. They just added a few things that they think are healthy. And then they throw in the towel because they think the diet doesn't work.
Yeah. And like you pointed out earlier, as one of the earlier misconceptions, that people, you know, people are expecting immediate results, right? It's just not going to happen. You have to do an incredible job over at least a couple of weeks, doing an incredible job, and then you will see results. But you can't just, like you said, put blueberries on your cheesecake.
And so they make small changes. They don't see the big results, and then they throw in the towel. So I always tell them that I don't want to stop you from making small changes. You know, I never want to dissuade that if that's your thing, but you got to keep moving forward.
Yep.
Small changes need to be a catalyst to keep moving forward until you're finally at a whole food plant-based diet. So it's big disconnect number four is they make little tiny changes and they still expect big results. And that's mm-hmm. not
mm-hmm. Yep. And then the last one, right? Number five.
Yeah. Big number five is if it's sold at a health food store, it must be healthy. So.
Oh, man. Yeah.
By the number of people that think that way. And, you know, I've had people come to me, well, it's sold at the health food store, right? So it obviously is healthy for you. And nothing could be further from the truth. I mean, there are healthy things at the health food store. But there's a lot of vegan junk food. And, you know, we have savvy marketers combined with uninformed consumers, and that's just a bad mix. So,
yeah, yeah. Well, I think what we're seeing, well, I can give two examples. Number one is they sell animal products at Whole Foods. I mean, that should blow the myth right there, right? If you're thinking, if you know anything about nutrition like you do, you know you want to avoid those animal products, and Whole Foods has them all over the place. The other thing is, like you said, the vegan junk food. I mean, I think so many of the larger food conglomerates are getting into the plant-based foods arena, and they're just producing animal product-free versions of the same harmful foods that they're already producing. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah. So, and product labels can be very deceptive too. They'll use the words, you know, light and gluten-free and fat-free and no cholesterol. So never believe the words on the outside of a package.
Right. Nothing on the, you have to go straight to the nutrition facts. And yeah. you still need to know exactly how to read that too, to make sure you're getting the right information off of it.
That's right.
So yeah, it's important. Yeah. Well, these are great things. I say that what when you combine all these five together, you've got just about everybody's reason for not being successful in you know, impacting their own health for the better. And yeah, if you got just, if you've even got just one, you may not be successful. And if you've got a couple of them, you may feel hopeless and not even realize why. So hopefully this video, you know, if you felt like that, this video will point out some things to check out. And, and like you said, straight out of your book, right? So more detailed information, I'm guessing, is in your book on these things, right?
Yes. And I actually have a big disconnect number 6, if you'd like to hear it.
Yes.
Big disconnect number 6 is called failing to own my own role in my health matters. Mm. You know how a lot of times, like you said, we trust our doctors. And yes. In the book, I call something called the 5 whys technique, WHY, you know, 5 whys. And this is something that Toyota Motor Corporation incorporated years ago when they'd have a glitch in their manufacturing. You have to ask why 5 times in order to get to the root cause of why something went wrong.
All right.
It might be 3 questions or it might be 7, but we just call it the 5 whys to get to the root cause. And if we would do that with our own health, mm-hmm. I have high cholesterol. Well, why? Mm-hmm. Because there's too much cholesterol in my blood. Well, why? You know, so you go down the list of whys until you get to the very root, which is usually the food, you know, and this is all explained in my book too.
Yes.
So once you do that and you figure out that, yeah, the food is the root of my health problems, then you're faced with a decision, right? I'm either going to change and eat a healthy diet or I'm not. And if you choose not, if you say, no, I'm not going to choose a healthy diet, then you need to start asking why there as well. Mm-hmm. Why am I willing to stay sick?
I hear you. Yeah. And this is tough. I mean, to really think about it on this level, because I think so many people, you know, I see almost, this is just my own, again, some of my own observations. I see, well, folks, they're like, if I question something, kind of along the lines of what we discussed here today, if I question something, because I'm seeing one of these 5 or 6 reasons pop up, someone will be like, oh, you don't trust science. You don't believe in science. Don't you think the doctors are looking at the science, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, and they're saying, well, who am I? Who am I to second guess what is told to me when I go to the medical office? You know, this is, of course, assuming that they're hearing a different message, because most of the time people do, not all the time, mm-hmm. but most of the time, I'd say. Right. So that whole paradigm, you know, people think that they're doing the intelligent thing, right? Mm-hmm. And then I am coming out of left field or something with something that is just made up almost, you know?
As if we have no science behind what we say, when actually science supports exactly, independent research supports us.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I agree. So thank you, you know, for all the work that you do in this category of living, because it, obviously we're at a point where hopefully we're at a transition. You know, there'll be a pendulum swing from old school, kind of like that we've witnessed for the past, I don't know, 50 plus years, 100 years, to a new way of thinking, which is really not new at all. As we know, it's the same old stuff that's been around for ages, right? Right. It's just that I think by choosing this, we admit that we don't have it all figured out. There's so many things that we don't realize, because I think that part of taking a pill and solving all your problems is thinking that we have it all figured out and we can remedy this, when the reality is, it's all lifestyle based, right? Whether it's the food lifestyle, the type of life we want to live outside of food, which may not be natural or conducive to humans, so many different things. I mean, but it's really about achieving balance. And I think that's what you're advocating, is just gathering all the information together, achieving balance, and really living, you know, you're having optimal health. So
yeah, I mean, we know that diet is the number one cause of disability and premature death, right? The foods that we put into our mouth. And I think a lot of times too, people believe it's just a natural rite of aging is to get heavy and sick. You know, everybody gets heavier and sicker as they age. That's just because things are catching up with them, but they just see that as a normal rite of passage into growing older. And it's truly not.
Yeah, yeah. And let me mention a few things about that. I think that hopefully when folks have reached retirement and are older age, like you're saying, that those will be the best years of someone's life, not a life filled with constant sickness and feeling bad, right? Because that's what happens if you don't do that. So like for me, I would look at it in the opposite way. And I would say, since I'm getting older, I have to get better because of the reasons you said. Because if you look around, you see that everyone's getting heavier and on maintenance meds and full of disease. Mm-hmm. I have to do better if I want to avoid that, which I do.
Right. You know, I turned 65 this year and went on Medicare. So that's an eye opener when you're old enough to qualify for a government program.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Well, I bet you are probably the healthiest person on that program that you've seen, if you've seen folks in it. So, yeah, because that's the thing. You don't look your age. You don't. And then really no one does. If you try to, like you said, take care of yourself in the way that you would take care of your car or something else.
Right. And that's part of big disconnect number 6, is that we all have personal responsibility, right, to take care of ourselves. And to deal, if we can't, we need to deal with those deeper issues as to why. Maybe we could talk about that someday. I've got a chapter on 12 reasons why people don't want to make changes.
Sure. I'd love that. That is, yeah, because I see it, because I think you and I can stand outside. We can look at someone else's life. We can see at least what they're telling us of their whatever medical conditions. We can determine in our minds. We probably know what's going on, but then it's just not that simple to convey the information. It just doesn't click like that with people, right? Because there's so many reasons as to why.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are many reasons. I was in that camp at one time. You know, I was just ignorant. One of the barriers is just blind ignorance, and that's where I was at one time. Mm-hmm. Dairy Queen blizzards and fish fries at the VFW. You know, that's where I was at one point. Okay. So I get it.
All right. Well, I look forward to that future talk. And again, if you all want to find out more information in detail, check out Sid Nodder's book, The Plan A Diet. And where can you get that?
At my website, sidnodder.com. You can get a signed copy there for $10, or you can get it on Amazon as well.
Okay. Awesome. Excellent. Thank you very much, Sid. Look forward to talking with you again in the near future.
Thanks, Mike. Have a great week.
You're welcome. You too. Bye-bye.
Bye.